Upbeat Alaska is brought to you by Coca-Cola, providing Alaskans with quality soft drinks since 1937.
By Cook Inlet Region Incorporated, an Alaska Native corporation promoting economic and social progress for people throughout the state.
By the generous support of the Alaska Native Health Board.
To Heartbeat Alaska. I'm Jeannie Green, bringing you Native news across the North. Thank you for joining me. Today we travel to Southeast Alaska to Ketchikan for a totem pole raising, then on over to Bethel where the inmates at the Yukon Kuskokwim Correctional Center invite us to their annual lunch. While we're in Bethel, we'll check out the Salmonberries. Later on in the program, we'll visit with the Athabascan Fiddlers, all that plus much more. Topping off our news now is Gary Fife with National Native News.
This is National Native News. I'm Gary Fife. The federal government's top Native official is now on the job. Ada Deer, a member of the Wisconsin Menominee tribe, was confirmed as Assistant Secretary for Indian Affairs last Friday. Interior Secretary Bruce Babbitt swore her in shortly after her Senate confirmation. Deer is the first woman to hold the post. In her confirmation hearing, she pledged to uphold the sovereign rights of Native people and to make the Bureau of Indian Affairs a more active and supportive institution. Although she's been sworn in by federal officials, her own Menominee tribe plans to conduct another ceremony and swear her in on their own in their powwow August 6th. Native athletes are gathering this week in Fairbanks, Alaska for the 33rd annual World Eskimo Indian Olympics. The three-day event brings together Native peoples who often don't see each other except for once a year, according to Paul Mountain, who's helping put together this year's games. The games have athletes compete in contests that sharpen their survival skills for Natives of the North. Opening ceremonies began Wednesday night with the race of the messenger. A fish cutting contest began Thursday morning, and the games close midnight Saturday after the muktuk or whale meat eating contest. The House of Representatives has approved its funding for Native housing programs at the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. The House side of Congress has voted to provide $257 million to construct 2,700 new tribal housing units. That's the same amount as last year. The Indian Home Loan Guarantee Program will guarantee up to $50 million in loans for the purchase of homes on reservations and tribal trust land. There's good news for veterans. Among other final items, the House included over $150,000 to enable the Native American Veterans Housing Loan Program to give direct home loans to Native veterans living on trust lands. Inupiaks of the northern coast of Alaska are pressing the federal government to bring the records of its Cold War Arctic research activities out into the open. As cleanup crews await their permit for cleaning up nuclear waste secretly brought to a coastal valley for tests in the 1960s, the North Slope Borough has consultants testing a suspicious-looking mound in Anaktuvik Pass in the Brooks Range. That's the same area where Natives were used as test cases for federal experiments with radioactive drugs. Local Natives say they weren't told about what materials were placed in the mound or about the effects of water runoffs. North Slope Mayor Jesley Kaliak says the vegetation and the water runoff bear distinct non-natural colors. The borough plans to have its own consultant study the mound. A theme has been announced for this year's convention of the Alaska Federation of Natives. The AFN has chosen Sharing Our Future, Commitment, and Responsibility as their focus for the convention, which begins October 14th in Anchorage. The agenda will include panels on economic development, leadership, and protection of culture. The popular Kiana Alaska dance presentation will run two nights starting October 13th. And finally, the honors continue to roll in for Scott Bear Don't Walk, a member of the Salish Kootenai and Crow tribes. The 1993 graduate of the University of Montana has already been selected as a 1993 Rhodes Scholar and will spend a year in England studying at Oxford University this fall. On top of that, Bear Don't Walk will be honored by his people of the Crow tribe as well. His academic achievements are being called the new road for today's Native warriors, and the Crows agree. They've named him as one of four warriors to lead the parade dance as a pipe carrier at this year's Crow Fair on August 23rd. Such an honor is usually reserved for military veterans or great leaders, and it's rarely given to anyone who has not been to war. The Billings Native Health Program is circulating a poster with the photos of the young Bear Don't Walk and his grandparents, with a quote from Crow Chief Plenty Coos that says, "With education, you are the white man's equal. Without it, you are his victim." This is National Native News, and for Heartbeat Alaska, I'm Gary Fife.
Thanks, Gary. We'll be back with more news after these messages from our sponsors. Don't go away.
We have always felt in harmony with the land.
Chakome, tapiwa, the skumuk, ta tapiachu, kenok anisce, matapiwa, makaspumos, akum.
Help the Soil Conservation Service help our earth. Call us today. We owe it to our children.
Jacob. Ruby.
Joseph. The names are many.
Walter.
People from the bush.
Buddy.
People from the cities.
Alex.
Eskimos.
Susan.
Aleuts. Indians.
George.
They're all our people.
Peter.
Deaths from alcoholism must stop.
Herman.
And there is help.
Julie.
It's at the Alaska Native
Moses.
Alcoholism Recovery Center.
Daniel.
Call ANARC now.
Alice.
For yourself.
Tommy.
For a friend.
Carl.
Or for a family member.
Mike.
Honor
Tina.
Our dead.
Jack.
But celebrate life.
Sergey.
Call ANARC.
Sam.
Rachel.
If you have news or information from your village or community, please call Heartbeat Alaska, area code 907-563-3507, or fax 907-563-7079.
We travel now to Southeast Alaska, to Ketchikan, a city close to my heart. Over the centuries, the Southeast Alaska Indians have evolved a beautiful, unique art form. Now, I've never been to a totem pole raising. Visit with me now as the totem pole for Chief Cayenne is raised. And thanks to the video provided by the Ketchikan Visitors Association and Ward Serrell, it's almost like we're there.
Chief Cayenne was the chief of the Tongass tribe in Ketchikan several generations ago. Little is known about Chief Cayenne other than some oral history. There's enough known, though, to warrant a totem pole raising on July 3, 1993. City of Ketchikan commissioned the carving of the totem pole. The totem pole is a symbol of the Tlingit culture and lineage. The original totem pole was commissioned by Chief Cayenne to be carved as a monument to his wife. Today's totem pole raising is a way for the Tlingits to carry on their tradition.
Where the poles are.
master Tlingit carver, Israel Shotridge, was commissioned in 1992 by the city of Ketchikan's Tongass Historical Museum to duplicate the pole. Historically, totem pole carvers were natives of wealth and high standing in the caste system. It was prestigious to have a member of the opposite clan carve the pole. 42-year-old Tlingit Israel Shotridge is a master carver. He studied under the guidance of well-known carver Nathan Jackson. He's also the son of Esther Shea. Today, there is no chief, as was known back then. However, Esther Shea serves as the tribal leader.
It is something like this that will keep our tradition alive, and our culture will never die as long as we keep this up. I thank all of you.
Flora Feller is the great-granddaughter of Chief Cayenne. Her Tlingit name is Kutlin. She's the last living great-grandchild of the late chief. Once the pole is raised, the traditional carver's dance tops off the ceremony. This day, Israel Shotridge celebrates the raising of the pole by dancing to the bear song, composed by his mother, Esther Shea. Shea, by the way, is the aunt of the chief's great-grandchild, Flora Feller. In Ketchikan, Alaska, the Tlingit culture, continuing the ceremony of pole raising, a tradition held strong by family ties.
As I gather information for my stories, I get the opportunity to speak to many remarkable people around the state. One of those people is Esther Shea. She spends time teaching the Tlingit language and the regalia tradition, as well as the traditional healing foods native to Southeast Alaska. We travel now to Bethel, where the inmates have a different kind of healing food. The Yukon Kuskokwim Correctional Center Culture Club invites us to lunch. The Native Culture Club at the Correctional Center plays host to the community at an annual picnic. It's a time to get together with families and people from the community to share a meal and pass the time with friends.
We've been going out fishing for all summer. We got so much fish. Hey, Dal, let's be sober and go fishing. You guys can do it too. It's very simple.
Percentage-wise, Alaska Natives make up a small portion of our population. Yet Alaska has more Natives in prison than in any other place in the world. Alcohol is one of the leading causes for these lopsided statistics. The Native Culture Clubs throughout the prison system give the inmates a sense of purpose, one of which is education.
I chose to be sober, and my wife and my family gave me a choice, my family or my bottle. And I decided to choose my family. It was a hard choice.
I did a rug musher and sobriety advocate, Mike Williams, was asked by the inmates to share his experiences.
And I would like to have a strong family, and for the last 8 years I've been able to abstain from using alcohol, even though I travel throughout the country. And inmates are very special people, and no matter what, each person that is alive today is very valuable.
Mike Williams speaks from the heart. Though sober now, at one time alcohol almost ruined his life. And tragically, it did take the life of loved ones.
My younger brother had a chance, and he worked on his own sobriety, but he doesn't have a chance anymore. But all the inmates, all you inmates right now, have a chance to make a difference when you get out of here. You are a very special person, and the whole goal should be not to have anyone at YKCC or incarcerated. And we know, we've heard reports over the years that Alaska Natives are filling up the prisons, and we need to turn around the trend and stop the revolving doors. Once a prisoner becomes a prisoner, it seems like he's a prisoner for life. But we want to change that, and it's up to all the agencies, all the communities, and people must unite together to arrest the problems that we are having, and turn that around. And we have the window of opportunity to do that, and each one of us must make a difference in
making a difference is a goal of the Native Culture Club. Promoting sobriety is the goal of Mike Williams. Even prison fences are no barrier.
I'm going to be running the Iditarod in 1994 again for sobriety, education, and opportunities. And I want to carry you on my sled, your signature, and I'll try my best to complete it, and it'll be my challenge to you. And I'll go through the trials and tribulations, and you have to do your part if you commit yourself to sobriety.
I'd like to thank the Yukon Kuskokwim Correctional Center Native Culture Club for inviting us to their 11th annual picnic and sharing their message across the North, an example of how even our incarcerated can make a difference. We'll be back with more video from Peter Twitchell right after these messages.
And I'm here to share with you today about our scrumptious deliumptious salmonberries, which are in season now. They are usually ready.
Vince, remember how we got our jobs telling people to buckle up?
Yeah, it seems just like yesterday.
Buckle up, baby, buckle up.
Next.
To buckle or not to buckle?
Next.
The band, the band.
Next.
We are never going to find a safety belt spokesperson.
Let's get buckled.
Yeah, we've helped save thousands of lives.
But some people still don't buckle up.
So let's hit it.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your safety belt.
My name is John, and I do watch Heartbeat Alaska, and you should too.
If you have news or information from your village or community, please call Heartbeat Alaska, area code 907-563-3507, or fax 907-563-7079.
Everyone loves berries, don't they? Around Bethel, the tundra is covered with them.
The old way was to store them in wooden barrels, and whenever you wanted to get a bunch out or a batch out to make a gudok, you just dipped your dipper in there. And
summertime in southwestern Alaska means berries, berries, and more berries. Native people all over the state consider the berries found in their area a special treat, and the tundra around Bethel is no exception.
Jamai, I'm Alex Mortensen. I work for KYUK as a producer-announcer, and I'm here to share with you today about our scrumptious deliumptious salmonberries, which are in season now. They are usually ready from the second week of July to the end of July, and that's the best time to come and pick some good salmonberries. You can make good agurak with them. You can make jam and jellies with them. There's a lot of things you can do with them. You can put them on your cake as toppings, but most likely we use them here to make agurak with. And that's our Eskimo ice cream, for those of you that don't know.
When I was a kid, we used to go out 2 weeks at a time and camp out and pick berries and put them in wooden barrels. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the folks would bring home maybe 200 gallons of salmon berries.
Like Peter Twitchell, Alex Mortensen's work keeps her busy. Yet she and many others in this Yukon-Kuskokwim Delta area still live a subsistence lifestyle. And like her ancestors for thousands of years before her, she's never too busy to harvest the bounty of the tundra.
I picked them, I put them in barrels, brought them back home. I had to go out to tundra. I went out to Agula area that's out in the tundra, and I spent a couple days picking these berries. And so what we do now is I take them home and I clean them. That they come with a little case. Sometimes you can pick them without
having a jacket
on.
Now is the time when the freezer gets stocked up with the winter supply. Of course, not all the berries make it that far.
Clean them, put them in a bag, and freeze them. And this little one will probably not get eaten until sometime in the middle of the winter.
Not when I'm around. From the beautiful Bethel country, this is Peter Twitchell, your camcorder reporter for Heartbeat Alaska.
Thanks, Peter. The people around the Bethel area are looking forward to some, in the words of Alex Mortensen, some scrumdelicious blackberries. Sounds pretty wonderful. Speaking of wonderful, Bill Stevens, who lives in Fairbanks, allowed us in his home to give us some background on his life as an Athabascan fiddler. Is an Athabascan fiddler. He was born on the Black River outside of Fort Yukon nearly 60 years ago. As a child, he was introduced to violin music at a village potlatch. He promised his mother he would do extra chores if she would buy him a fiddle of his own. Well, she did, from Sears Roebuck catalog. It cost $25. Today, Bill Stevens is in demand to play old-time jigs all over the state.
But I fooled around with it and learned a little bit, just enough to play a couple of few tunes, and then I left for Mount Edgecombe, and I didn't play after that because there's a dormitory there and I'm a shy person and I don't want to play with all those other students. So I didn't play for a period of about 15 years. I went back to Fort Yukon and went trapping. And then in 1960, I left for California. And I was in California for the entire 1960s and 70s. And came back to Alaska in 1982. In 1975, I took up the fiddle again. The cost fiddling was really popular in California, old-time fiddling and bluegrass and all that sort. There have been a lot of fiddle contests, and I played in quite a few of them. Got a few trophies, and proud of them.
Almost 150 years ago, Hudson Bay Company traders from Scotland and the Orkney Islands and French-Canadian travelers came to the interior of Alaska, introducing the fiddle and the traditional music from their homelands to the Athabascan people of Fort Yukon. The Alaskan Athabascans liked the music so well, they quickly adopted it, modified the sound with a blend of their own traditional Indian music, and produced what we call today Athabascan old-time fiddling. Over the years, this blend of European, Canadian, and Athabascan music has evolved and been modified by the particular style of the Yukon village in which it's played. The villages upriver kept the Scottish Orcadian influence strong, while the downriver villages favored the country western music that they had been fondly playing on phonographs ordered from Sears Roebuck Company catalogs. Athabascan Old Time Fiddling Festival, held every year in Fairbanks.
I can just tell by attending these festivals that the elders and the youngers both enjoy old time fiddling and the dancing that goes with it. And it looks like it's going to survive for a long time. And I'm really proud of that.
And we're proud of you too, Bill Stevens. And a special thanks to the family member that took that video, and thanks once again for allowing us into your home. And thank you for joining me here on Heartbeat Alaska, Native News Across the North. I'm Jeannie Green. Join me again next week, won't you? See you then.